Thank you, everybody. It was always nice to come at the EuroPython venue. This time, I have a very generic title, Python Scientific Computing, What Works and What Doesn't. And when I submitted this title, I realized that maybe it was too much ambitious, like I know everything about scientific computing, which is not the case. So let me specify a bit what I mean about scientific computer, what I'm going to talk about. So where I come from, now I work at this foundation in Pavia, in Italy, which is called GEM, like Global Earthquake Model. And essentially, we work on earthquakes. So one of the first, actually the first project the foundation was involved in, it was the seismic map of Europe that you see here. It was the shared collaboration at ETH Zurich. And actually, the engine was developed first to make it possible to plot these kind of maps. So we do both the hazard, means real the earthquakes, but also the risk, meaning we can give you a map saying how much damage there will be in this region, how many people will die for earthquakes, things like that, and even more stuff. So this is the kind of calculations we are doing. And in particular, these are relatively large calculations. You need a cluster to run those. We are producing lots of data. By lots of data, I mean something like 100, 200 gigabytes of data. Then you may think it's not so big, but let's say medium. It's something that you cannot manage easily on a single machine. You need really some infrastructure. And then we have a non-trivial post-processing on top of this generated data. This generated data depends, but can be typically is the ground motion field, so the peak ground acceleration, so how big is the earthquake in each point in Europe, let's say, okay? Actually, we have a seismic map of the whole world now, so we are able to do really large things. There is a mosaic of models, but we are able to cover all the world. And this non-trivial post-processing is having the hazard, we are able to compute the risk, so you have to read gigabytes of data and post-process. And of course, we have all the time problems like we are running out of memory, data transfer. Of course, the speed is of paramount importance, so lots of CPU number crunching. And I have a picture here that maybe I should refresh. Oh, okay. This is a screenshot that our sysadmin took from our cluster. And there are more or less 500, a bit more than 500 cores running now. These actually are two different calculations, two different clusters, but we are also able to connect everything in a single cluster. So you see, there is a lot of CPU going on and a lot of work here. What's behind this kind of picture? So what I'm going to talk now is mostly about what are the libraries that we have used and how was our experience with these libraries. So if I say this library is bad, does not mean that the library is bad. It was bad for our use case. Or maybe it was good, but we were not able to use it properly. This is also possible. So don't think this as a criticism or something, or some library, specific library. Anyway, let me start from NumPy, SciPy, which I guess everybody knows in the Python world. They are the standard. They also are the one with less problems. Essentially, are the biggest reliability you can have is NumPy, SciPy, the battle-tested. Still, I would like to point out that even the most battle-tested, even the best libraries, you can have troubles with. Actually, we had troubles in the past. It was an old version of NumPy. I think now that the problem has disappeared. But the problem I had here was with structured arrays. So we use these structured arrays, which are like records. OK, it's a future NumPy, which has been there for years and years. But this did not play well with Pico and Unpico. So when I had this structured array, was returning back from the workers to the controller node, because of course we have a distributed situation and you have a controller and then workers. got in trouble. It means that all my tests were green, everything was working, demos were working, but once you started the real big calculation, you were getting back bogus numbers, essentially, for some strange reason that I never discovered. At the end, I solved because instead of using structural arrays, I used plain regular arrays, and then was going on. But this is one of the things that may happen, that we have a library that works perfectly well in small cases. Then you try in the big case, and something strange happens. Something strange can be a segmentation fault, can be an error, but can even be, and unfortunately often is, that you get bogus numbers, like all zeros instead of the right numbers, or even random numbers, and you know. So it's a bit tricky, and scaling can be very, can give some surprises. So, NumPy, SciPy are the core. Then we also use a lot H5PY, which is a Python wrapper built on top of the HDF5 library, which is in C. Do you, raise your hands if you know about H5PY, HDF5. Okay. I would say at least half of you knows. It's a very good library if you have to store arrays, and more than arrays, you can also store attributes of these arrays. You can, it's also hierarchical, you can have a hierarchy of arrays. So it's very good, it's very efficient. It is more than 20 years old, the C part. The H5PY, the Python part, is newer, but still has been there for a long time. Still, I would say it is not perfect. And this certainly is on a level of maturity much less than NumPy. So we had issues, in particular these structural arrays that we use a lot. Also issue with these variable length arrays. The variable length arrays as a feature, when you have, let's say you have an array with rows and columns, and let's say that for each row, the number of columns can be different. It's not a real array, it's a list with a variable number of columns, okay? This kind of structure is very convenient, especially if you have arrays which are, let's say, mostly empty. So maybe this row you have only 10 columns and the other you have 100 columns, but you don't want to fill everything. So they are convenient, but in the past in particular, but even in the present, they gave some problem. Another problem that I did not expect was the byte string issues. Because you can say, oh, but this is a library for arrays, where do we have the strings? The strings are in the attributes, because in the HDF5 world, you can store also attributes to these for the arrays, and these attributes can contain strings. And they are never sure if they are strings, they are their bytes. So, I mean, you are sure, but when you have to support at the same time both Python 2 and Python 3, it was a bit tricky to get it right, more tricky than I expected. Now we have migrated everything to Python 3, so now everything's fine, easy, no problem anymore. But to support both at the same time was a bit tricky. So this is, I'm giving some caveats. And then there was this very recent debacle, I call it, because it was really a big problem. Because we were using until 1 month ago the HDF5 1.8, which is now end of the line. So, it's not yet deprecated, but the last version was released, and now they say now the 1.10 is the future. And we did this 1.10 upgrade, and we lost a feature, essentially. Break some stuff. One feature we lost was that before, while the calculation was running and writing on the file, you can open another process and see what was inside that file. Of course, since another process was writing, you were not sure that the file was in a consistent state. So maybe once in a while you tried to read what was in there, you got an error in the reader, and that was fine for us. Okay, it's an error, somebody's writing, it's an error. But 99% of the time, you were getting a good result. So you could see essentially the progress of calculation, because in this HDF5 file, we save the data. So we can see, I wrote, I don't know, 12 megabytes out of 20, so I know how much stuff I stored. I can see what's the, also the percentage of calculation is there. So I could see that. Now I cannot, because now there is a lock. So 100% of the time is impossible to see what's inside the file, because another process has the exclusive lock. So in theory, it's more secure. In practice, it was a bit annoying for us. Also, this new version of the library has a mode which is called a single writer, multiple reader, that should solve the problem, because if you enable this mode, multiple reader can read the file while somebody else is writing. But I was not able to get this mode running in our use case. Okay, there are examples there in the library, works, but did not work until now in our case, because it's more complicated, of course, than the textbook exercise. So I'm still fighting. Maybe we will be able to fix this. But still, was not easy, this transaction. Also, the HDF view, if you have used it, HDF view is a tool that is provided by the H5 consortium that allows you to see what's inside the file. The old version, okay, is not able to read the new format. So we have to use the new version of the HFI 3.0, it's called the viewer. But this viewer had some regression, so I cannot read files that contains variable length arrays with a structured data type, which was what we were using. But before it was working, now it is not working, but kind of annoying. There is another tool which is called Silk View. It's a Python tool, while the HDF view is in Java. Silk is in Python. And it works better. It works better in the sense that he had the same bug. I was not able to read the structured arrays, but I opened a pull request in the GitHub repository of the Silk View, and after 2 hours, they fixed the issue. So in this sense, I like it. They're very responsive. So if you have trouble, maybe you can consider using Silks. Oh, no, wait. Oh, by far, the most difficult for us, the most problematic issue with HDF5 was in situation of parallelism. So there is what I call a fork, but it has to do with the fork. So if you follow the workflow that I've written here, so first create the file, close the file, then fork. Fork when you call a multiprocessing, okay? Multiprocessing is doing a fork on Linux. So if you close the file, then fork, and you read the data, it works. Of course, you have to save on a different file, because you can write, read and write at the same time, at least with the, in the old, now there is the single writer mode, but it doesn't work very well. So we have to do different files. So the problem is that if you forget to close the file, for instance, or you remember to close the file, but you have another piece of your code which is opening the file, and you don't know that, and this happened, of course. So what happens is that sometimes you get the right result, sometimes works, test green. Sometimes you get an error, like the file is corrupted or something like that. Sometimes you get bogus numbers. Very, very annoying, very, very annoying. So, and this H5PY, I say, is evil in the sense is not really helping you much. For instance, discover that if you go outside the limit, there is a side limit on the attributes. If you go out of that limit, you get a segmentation fault. And it's not clear what caused that. In the old version, it was working. In the new version, it's not working. So it's not so easy to use this library if you have very large calculation things going on, because we are writing hundreds of megabytes of data. On the other hand, it's really, really, really fast. So we are not going to abandon HDF5. It's really I couldn't find anything better on the point of view of the performance. It's very good at the performance. And in every time we had the problems, I was able to find the workaround, essentially. So this is also good. Then we are using a lot of geospatial libraries. And on this point, maybe I will be fast. I will go fast, and you can ask me after the talk. There are issues even with the geospatial libraries. Not everything is easy. But the probably most difficult things are the installation. So particularly because Shapely is doing some monkey patching inside. So if you don't have the right version, maybe it works on Linux but does not work on Mac OS. There are all kinds of problems with these libraries. A bit tricky. We also use QGIS. We had a problem. QGIS was using a version of LibGeos. It was incompatible with the version of LibGeos that we were using the engine, so you cannot use the same code base. At the end, we had to do a client-server approach, so we put a web interface on top of the engine. QGIS was going through the web interface and not importing directly, because otherwise you have a problem with the incompatible version of library. So there are issues here, but maybe ask me later. Then, instead, what I want to talk a bit more is this Rabbit MQ and Celery combination, because the way we are doing concurrency on a cluster now is using Celery Rabbit MQ, which is not the ideal technology to use. It was not my choice, let's say. It was inherited from the past. And we were able in these six or seven years that we are using, we were always be able to found workarounds and get this working, so we're still using it. It's not the fault of Celery or RabbitMQ, that I think are very good libraries. The problem is they are meant for a different use case, because our use case, we have to transfer large arrays. You have to transfer gigabytes of arrays, and this is optimized for small messages, not for this. And also, RabbitMQ has a database which is called Amnesia, where you store intermediate results and messages, essentially, which is useful for resilience, because in theory, if the calculation dies, you can restart. But this is not, we don't use that feature. For us, if a calculation dies, okay? Instead, what happens is that we have a very large calculation. Typically, you run out of disk space because RabbitMQ is trying to store everything in Amnesia, and at a certain moment, you run out of disk space, which for us is bad. For us, it would be better to run out of memory immediately, and then we can find a way to change the calculation, solve it instead. After hours, maybe you run out of disk spaces. It's still not the fault of the technologies, but it's not optimized for our use case. Also, it's very complex, the RabbitMQ. There is configuration, there are users, there are touching parameters they should not touch, and then they have strange errors. So if we had something simpler, we would be happy. Also, we thought about using, instead of Celery with RabbitMQ, using Celery with Redis, which is lightweight, everything is in memory. Thought that the performance should be better. But then the revoke functionality, you say, there is something went wrong. Please kill all the tasks which are running. That revoke functionality did not work with Redis, and this was something 2 years ago. Did not try again recently. Maybe now it works. We don't know. But still, this is the reason why at the time we tried, but didn't work to use Redis or something different as RabbitMQ with Celery. Also, the default configuration is not the ideal one. There are some parameters to tune that we have to change, otherwise it will not work so well. And particularly at the beginning, 5 years ago, we had this, let's call memory leak, so that all the results, so I'm producing 1 terabyte of data, all this terabyte of data was kept in memory. Because let's say I had 1,000 tasks, each task 1 gigabyte, 1,000, 1 terabyte, all terabyte was kept in memory. And we had to monkey patch the library at the time. Now probably there is a flag to avoid the monkey patch, but still. We asked the mailing list, and they gave us the answer. So there is good support, it's a good library. It's just it's not meant for this kind of very large calculations. The worst problem we had with salary was, I don't know, last year. This we had salary waiting for a ready completed task. So we don't know why. And for some calculation, but only for some, not for all, was reproducible. What happened was that everything was finished, but salary was waiting for something that was already returned. So what the calculation was hanging, okay? 0% CPU on all the cluster, hanging why? So we did, we discovered that, for instance, we reduced the number of cores because we 256 core, problem. 192 cores, problem. With 128 cores, was working. So it's a scale issue inside. We don't know exactly if it was inside the RabbitMQ. We don't know if it was inside the Celery. It was really ugly. So this is why, yeah. Of course, Celery has more than 50,000 lines of code. It's not so easy to go there and see what's happening. And the part in Erlang is even worse, okay? What do you do as a Python programmer? And also, even when everything works, there are still limits on the data, amount of data you can transfer. So if I want to transfer 10 gigabytes in 10 hours, not a problem. You can transfer, works fine. But if you want to transfer these 10 gigabytes in 1 minute, what happens that you will get an error. In the Celery, I mean, the BQ side, you will get an error that, like, this essentially is too much data transfer, okay? So there are problems on scale. So we needed, what we needed was a plan B to progress. And the plan B for us was ZeroMQ. So I knew about ZeroMQ for a long time, for years probably, but was never really interested in going there. At the end of last year, during the summer, I decided to study. We had these problems, we had this salary hanging, so I said, let's study a bit ZeroMQ and see if we can do something. So during my vacation, I studied the ZeroMQ book, very nice, did some experiment, works. There was some problem, but essentially, I'm very happy with ZeroMQ. I can recommend it. I would like to have ZeroMQ inside the Python standard library if it were me. So in the first pages of the book, there is this push-pull pattern. I follow that. Essentially, after some attempts, et cetera, it worked. So I can now transfer 10 gigabytes in 1 minute without any problem. Still, you have a problem at the Python level because you cannot pickle or unpickle array which are too large, over some, I don't know, 4 gigabytes, I think. And that's, you cannot do anything. But from the point of view of the ZeroMQ, it was really, really well. We discovered one issue, that the packets keep circulating. What does mean this? If you have a calculation, you run calculation number 23, and this gives back to the controller node data. Then something goes wrong, like out of memory, so the calculation dies. And then you start another one, calculation 24. This calculation 24 will see packets coming from the old calculation, from the number 23, because they are not lost. They live there. So what we found, it was relatively easy to fix because we have the calculation number. If you get a packet which is not for the calculation you are running, so from a old one, you just discard it. So there was something to look a bit, but essentially we are really happy with the ZeroMQ. It worked very well, and now we are using it in conjunction with Celery. So we are still using Celery, but we are returning back the big arrays with ZeroMQ, not with Celery. Why? Because we don't want to reinvent the wheel. Well, for instance, we also have a way to run everything without Celery using only ZeroMQ. except that the revoke functionality does not work. So I should be there and trying to reinvent the revoke functionality, so killing all the tasks. I did not want to reinvent this. Also because I'm a physicist by originally, so I'm not a system programmer. I don't really want to reinvent this kind of stuff. So I did what was possible to do in 2-3 days, 1 week, fine. For the rest, probably we should use a different technology which does everything for us. This different technology may be Dask. Maybe Dask, we are experimenting with it. I'm here to talk with you guys. If you have experience using Dask, please, after the talk, talk with me, tell me. What I can say that, years ago, I know about Dask since the beginning, but we are conservative. We said, it's too recent, let's wait, let's see. The documentation was not clear, at least to me. I thought Dask was all about task dependencies, graphs, complicated stuff. Instead, there is this Dask distributed client map, which is exactly what we were doing. I need a replace for a map. Instead of doing the map in Celery, let's do the map with Dask. So, and essentially, I tried out in 2 hours, I got something working on a single machine. For the cluster, our sysadmin tried to install it and says that it works, everything is low. So we are at the beginning. We will see if we will use it or not. Then I want to talk a bit about what we are not using, which can also be of interest to you. What we are not using are C extensions, Cython, Numba, or this Intel Python that I mentioned because Intel Python is a sponsor of this conference. Yesterday there was a talk, a training made by the Intel guys. Very nice talk, I was there, I attended. So I want to mention why we are not using it. So C extension, we actually used them in the past. This was before the invention of Python wheels. And before the invention of Python wheels, it means that we want to install a software which depends on the C extension, you need to have a compiler on the client machine. And this was an issue, particularly in Windows, because we would not expect our users to have the ability to install a GCC compiler. So what we were doing, we had a fallback. We had this part, which is compiled. If you have the compiler, et cetera, OK. If you don't have it, there was a Python replacement for it. This part was computing essentially distances, OK, distances on the sphere. But it was bad, because essentially we had duplication of logic. The logic was kind of complex, more than you would expect. So we had this part in C, this part in Python, and if you change something, you have to change in 2 places. Then there was also the big issue of the migration to Python 3, because the part in C was written for Python 2, and we wanted to migrate. And also, there was another issue that I'm not a C programmer, and also I don't want to be a C programmer. So and the one who wrote that part left the company years ago. So who was going to maintain, et cetera. So essentially, the problem was solved because I was able to speed up the Python part and just drop the dependency, OK? And our code base now is 100% pure Python, except the part that runs in NumPy, SciPy, et cetera. But from our point of view, 100% Python is really, really nice to have that. Cython is good. I mean, I was here at this conference, followed some Cython training 2 years ago. It would be better than plain C, because at least it would solve the problem Python 2, Python 3, because I write a single code. But when I tried it on that code for the distance calculations, the speed up I got was, I don't know, 20%, not really significant. So if there is an order of magnitude difference, then OK. But if it's 20%, it's not worth the effort. Also, a lot of our code is not suitable for Cytonization in the sense that it's code that we don't write, because we have a library of a ground motion prediction equation. Okay, the ground motion prediction equation is the equation that predicts the earthquake. It predicts how big will be the ground motion. And this part can be written by our users, which are typically scientists. And these scientists want to write Python. We don't want them to require to install Python. It would be everything would be more complicated. Okay. I'm at the end. And we said, no, not for a moment. Tried also Numba. Tried Numba on this, always on this distance computation part, the part that was in C originally. And even here, I could not get a substantial speed up, except by using the parallel option, because Numba has an option that you can parallelize your code for you. But there is a trick, because we were already calculating everything in parallel. So if you are already calculating everything in parallel, then you use a library which is also parallelized. We have a problem of nested parallelism, which is, I discovered yesterday, is called oversubscription. Essentially, there is too much contention. And at the end, you get that your calculation is lower than before. So, and also, Numba uses more memory. We have a problem because we easily run out of memory. And the end, what I discovered that SciPy spatial distance, which is a function in SciPy, which is already our dependency, was always faster than the approach I was using, always, sometimes even one order of magnitude faster. And so I said, let's switch that. And now distances are no more a bottleneck for NAS. Not a problem. For what concerns Intel Python, OK, there is some concerns about vendor locking because we don't want to force people to use one specific technology, OK, but it's not really that. It's really that even if yesterday the trainer saw a speed up 100 times, when I tried on my code, it was slower. So I will talk with the guys at Intel, probably. And so for the moment, my point is I will wait another year. One year ago, I tried and was slower, and this year is still slower. So. And then there is also this point that this is my last slide. I want to close here. I also don't want to spend too much time in technologies because typically the best use of your time is to think about the algorithm you are using. Okay? If something is low, you go to the scientist and say, but do you really need to do all of this calculation? Because 99% of the time, there is a workaround. There is another way. You don't really need to do that. And you can get impressive speedups. Like, for instance, 1 week ago, no, 2 weeks ago, we had a calculation for Canada was taking weeks to run for 11 cities in Canada, and discovered that for those 11 cities, you could use another approximation and do things 100 times faster, okay? Because we are doing more calculation than needed, that actually the difference was within the error that you have. So this is also the biggest reason why I don't want to try all the technologies in the world, want to spend my time trying to find solution on the scientific side, let's say. And that's it. I'm open for questions.
We're not going to be passing the microphone, so if you have questions, can you go downstairs here and ask your question, please?
I was wondering if you have any experience using the X-Array library as sort of bringing together NumPy, Pandas, Dask, and
FTF5? No, didn't try everything, so sorry, this is rather new, I guess.
I'm not sure how new it is, actually, but it seems to be bringing together all of the technologies that you mentioned.
I heard it, but I never tried.
Thanks.
Does your problem fit into the MapReduce paradigm, for example? Have you tried, for example, PySpark or something like that?
But PySpark is a big technology stack. There's also the Java part, et cetera. So want to have our constraint, we have something which is simple. You can install your laptop because most of your users are also scientists that maybe they are not doing this large stuff. So we need something that works on the small, but you can scale up on the cluster in the, let's say, easiest way possible. Okay.
You mentioned one of the tools from Dask to actually use the migration part you mentioned. I'm not sure, could you explain that part a bit?
The migration for Python 2, Python 3?
The Dask, like map.
Yes, I understand what you mean now. Yes. Essentially, what we are doing here, we have a map, okay, functionality, which if you are using multiprocessing, it just pull map, actually star map, okay. If we are using Celery, there is something similar. And if you are using Dask, I use this client map. I'm using this map functionality everywhere. So since now Dask is exposing this interface, for me it was, I don't know, 5 lines of code to change to dispatch it, because we have a wrapper over different parallelization mechanisms, and by specifying a configuration, you can choose which parallelization to use. So if I have a map framework, everything is easy for me. I can support in the Open Quick Engine that technology.
I want to thank you, Michael.
There is one question,
sorry.
Hello. You talk about H5P. Do you have, by any chance, have time to test Pandas?
Pandas?
Yeah.
Pandas, our scientists are using Pandas a lot. We are not using it in the engine because Pandas is mostly to process data.
Yeah.
So my job is to generate the data more than so it's numeric simulation. So it's not our dependence of us. So I tried it, but not. I cannot say much about Pandas.
Okay, thank you.
We don't have time for more questions. Sorry. Okay. So again, I want to thank you, Michele.
I am here if you want to ask questions. Coffee break or later.
It was a great talk. I really like how do you finish the talk. That I think I agree with you that improvements on algorithms is more important than on tools.
Yeah.
The next session is going to start in 5 minutes, and it's going to be about reinforcement learning. And thank you very much.